This is the Truth Frequency Radio Network.
We are TFR.
Truth Frequency Radio.
From the biggest little city in the world in the clear blue waters of Lake Tahoe, broadcasting from an undisclosed location in the Truckee River Valley on Truth Frequency Radio, this is the Awakening Liberty Show with Sean Carone. Hello and welcome to the Awakening Liberty Show right here on truthfrequencyradio.com, your protection from deception all across America, all around the world. The number to call in is 866-26-TRUTH. Again, that number is 866-268-7884. We've got our new toll-free lineup. If that one for some reason doesn't work, you can always call 213-233-3998 and we'll be opening up the phone lines in today's show. We're going to have a very interesting one. Anthony Patch will be joining us again today for part two of our look at CERN and the ancient Tower of Babel connections, plus a myriad of other things. We're going to talk about the August 21st eclipse, stolen gold coins, and September 23rd end time prophecy questions. So join us live. Again, you can hang out in the chat room or you can call in. Again, that number is 866-26-TRUTH. Today's broadcast contains truth. It may in whole or in part be intercepted, impeded, interrupted, stolen, stored, used, and misused by a broad set of intelligence agencies, hackers, professional thieves, government operatives, and creeps. And it seems to me that we don't have any problems if I mention Kim Kardashian's backside. For some reason, that throws the NSA and those who would be listening off. So, again, I will always mention the name. The Awakening Liberty Show is now being carried live on IPMNation.com, iHeartRadio, TuneIn, and the K-Star Talk Radio Network. Also, my affiliates listening on rebroadcast, I'd like to welcome you as well. Pyramid One Channel 2 Network, WLIR Australia, and, of course, YouTube. Thank you so much for your love and support on YouTube. We have now just exceeded... We're actually approaching 3,600 subscribers. Thank you so much for your support and helping the station and TFR and my YouTube channel grow and what I'm doing here. I can't express my gratitude enough to you all. You can also listen by phone. So anywhere you are, make it TFR. Listen by phone number is 641-793-7117. Again, 641-793-7117. And if you want to look me up on social media, again, YouTube at Awakening Liberty Show. You can also check me out at Awakening Liberty Show on Facebook as well. That's my like page. And you can also check me out on Twitter at Awakening Lib. And again, thank you so much to everybody who has supported the show. Much gratitude to you all. Websites, real quick, awakeninglibertyshow.com. Again, AwakeningLibertyShow.com. Stop by, say hello, subscribe to my calendar so you can keep up to date as to all of my upcoming guests. And we've got some doozies coming up for you. We're starting to book for June. Actually, we're already booked out halfway through June. And just stop by AwakeningLibertyShow.com and check out what I got coming up. I am taking a couple weeks off, Mother's Day through July 3rd or June 3rd, I believe. Need a much needed break. We're going to go on vacation. We're going to visit with my mom and grandparents and just enjoy life, because I'll tell you, sometimes this matrix that we're living in and all of this garbage going on can weigh heavily on you. So I am going to take a much needed break. Also, AwakeningLibertyStore.com. You can stop by there. You can link directly to it from AwakeningLibertyShow.com. Stop by and check out what I've got. Shop the rest. Come by and shop me first. when you're done and buy, because we have the best non-GMO made in USA emergency food storage in the business with a myriad of other survival products, including Ilios solar powered backup generator systems by Bannock. They're absolutely incredible. May Day Madness is going on right now. You can actually go and get 15% off using coupon code MAYDAY at awakeninglibertystore.com. That's MAYDAY. Get 15% off your entire order, and there's no minimum purchase required. So just stop by, check it out, get some of our sample packages. Also on AwakeningLibertyShow.com, check out the new L.A. Marzulli video that he has just done. It's pretty fascinating. I love it. And it's the Watchmen Chronicles. In their own words, UFOs are real. And as we know, L.A. Marzulli is on board with many of us Christians who do believe that UFOs and the whole phenomena is real, but we are in fact dealing with fallen angels. But check that out. 1999 Awakening Liberty Show special L.A. Marzulli promo at AwakeningLibertyShow.com. You know, last week we had Kent Hovind and his wife Mary Hovind, or AKA Mary Toko, on as well. But we had some guest connection issues in that first segment. While we were sorting those out, I started to talk about the faith, grace versus works controversy in the emerging church and the Christian faith at the present time. And it is a growing controversy. And the reason I want to reiterate some of this is because I'm taking a lot of flack and a lot of heat for some of the things that I have said. But I want to try and clarify that, because I didn't get a chance to really sum up my thoughts last week in that first segment. So I'm going to take a minute to do so before we bring Anthony Patch on. Antinomian Christians believe that the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ abolished the law, and it did. But the question we have to ask ourselves is, which law? Was it his moral laws, or was it the Mosaic Covenant? I suggest to you that Yahweh's moral law remains the same under both covenants, and it applies to all of us still. Now, antinomian or antinomianism, defined as relating to the view that Christians are released by grace from the obligation of observing the moral law. I certainly don't agree with this. I wouldn't say I am antinomian. I would say that I am pronomian. Now, Paul writes in Romans, "For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness." I'm going to repeat that. "For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth." In the King James Version, chapter 10, verse 4. Now, again, what law is Paul referring to? The added law at Mount Sinai, referred to as the Mosaic Covenant, were the laws for righteousness. There's that word again, the phrase, laws for righteousness. In effect, the compulsory laws Yahweh deemed necessary 430 years after giving Abraham his statutes, commandments, and judgments. And then it was later codified by Moses. The Mosaic Covenant was added because of Israel's transgressions. They did not love Yahweh or their fellow man enough to freely comply with his moral law, which had been in existence since the beginning of time. They've always been there. They've always been the same. They haven't changed. Now, Yahweh put the Israelites under compulsory compliance, essentially in custody, by way of the Mosaic Covenant and its sacrificial and ceremonial ordinances. Under that covenant, the Israelites were compelled to keep his laws in order to be justified before God. Now, that is the schoolmaster that Paul refers to in Galatians 3. Which Galatians 3, often antinomian Christians point to as saying that we are no longer under the law. But again, I keep asking the question, which law? This is something that's bothered me for a long time. Moses explains it in the following way, "And it shall be righteousness unto us if we observe to do all this commandment before the Lord our God as he hath commanded us." That's Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 25. It was the compulsory compliance for righteousness that Christ abolished, not Yahweh's moral laws, in my opine and how I look at it scripturally. Because Paul then writes later on, "Do we make void the law through faith? God forbid, yea, we establish the law," Romans 3:31. Now, identifying which law Christ abolished in his life, death, and resurrection, in his sacrifice, is key to understanding what I'm talking about here. Paul did not say that Jesus was the end of the law, period, but rather he was the end of the law for righteousness. In effect, the Mosaic Covenant, through those sacrificial and ceremonial ordinances. Thank God, praise God, amen, that we don't have to atone for our sins by taking a goat up into the mountains and slaughtering it. It's an awfully bloody way to stay righteous in front of God. Again, not Yahweh's commandments, statutes, and judgments. That was not what Christ abolished. There are dangerous teaching in today's churches, in my opinion. And dare I say it, it's for personal gain, to grow congregations. Many churches are teaching what people want to hear. And this is the adversary infiltrating Christianity. I am unequivocally convinced that that is what is happening. And all I got to do is look at the way some people live their lives. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3. For a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound and wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desires and will look for teachers who will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. Now, I can understand that to a degree, because I wanted to live my life that way too. I got into the metaphysics and the New Age thing, and God loves us no matter what, and I can still be saved by Jesus Christ and his life, death, and resurrection as long as I believe. But then I can go out and do whatever I want to do. Do as thou wilt. We're talking about Aleister Crowley here. We're talking about satanic agendas. Now, to clarify my position on this, do I believe we must perform works to be saved? No. I don't think you need to do anything other than profess that you believe in Jesus Christ. Whether or not we can lose that is another question, and I'm not even going to go in there. Eschatology, all concerned, you know, I'm just going to look at this in the fact that what I know in my heart. Do I believe that we voluntarily, with free will, must choose to obey God's commandments, statutes, and judgments? Yes. Do I believe that we as Christians can do as thou wilt and will avoid judgment simply because we believe? Absolutely not. Because of Christ, do I believe that we are free to rape, steal, and murder simply because we believe? Should I drink, drug, and engage in perversions because I believe? No. The mere act of choosing not to do these things are works, yes? Or non-works, as the case may be. Will every Christian fail miserably while he is here in this earthly realm? Well, maybe not all, but I'd say 99% of us will fail miserably. So unequivocally, yes. But grace is the solution after we sin. And from personal experience, it ebbs and flows. As I make decisions based on his will, or I slip into those transgressions and run on my own will and my own desires, I'm very conscious of this. I can feel God's grace, and I can feel when it slips away because my head is elsewhere. I start living my life in this world, or of this world. But I willfully, every day, attempt to live under Yahweh's commandments, statutes, and judgments. I make an effort to turn from habitual sin, out of love for Yahweh and the sacrifice of Christ. And again, I say, are these not works? In closing, under Abrahamic and Christian covenants, those same commandments, statutes and judgments written in our hearts and minds, as said in Psalm, are to be obeyed voluntarily out of our love for Yahweh and our fellow man. Jesus and his sacrificial death and resurrection did not abolish Yahweh's law, but reestablished it as Yahweh initially intended it to be observed from the beginning. Yet we know what happened in the garden. Things went awry. And that's what God did, is he reset everything. He gave us the chance, the free will, to choose him over the adversary, which we are all facing today. I am compelled not to sin because of my faith, yet I still do. That's very frustrating to me. And it saddens me, which I think probably constitutes repentance. So I struggle with that, and I know other Christians struggle with that. It's very difficult. We're bombarded with Hollywood and the music industry and what we see in commercials, especially when it comes to sexuality. And then we see the whole transgender movement, the LGBT community, all of this stuff. Those are the perversions that are sucking us in. And I think that's why porn is so pervasive in our society, is because Satan, the adversary, he knows that that is the one thing that will really grab us, because God made us to be sexual beings. I fear God, and I fear the day I will stand before him in judgment, as we all will. For I don't have any justifiable excuses for the way I live much of my life. But my faith, my belief in Jesus Christ, and the humble act of asking for forgiveness We call that humility. But asking for forgiveness for my iniquities is where I lay my hope. Do I believe because of the way I lived my life and even the fact that I still sin that I'm going to burn in hell? No. I've often said that I will be happy at the lowest spot in heaven if I obtain it. And I believe I will. And I believe all of us who do believe and do on a daily basis try to turn from habitual sin and turn away from our own wills, we will go to heaven, regardless of what we've done. So, but I also believe at the same time, I have got to make an effort to actually obey the commandments and statutes and judgments of God. I think as Christians, we all are bound by standing up for God and standing up for his moral laws in all aspects of life. So I wanted to clear that up a little bit because I get lots of emails about my stance on antinomianism versus pronomian ideology that I see in the church so much today. And I hope that kind of clears it up for you as to where I'm standing. Is it hard? Yeah, it's hard to follow God's laws. It's very difficult. But we do the best we can. God knows we're losers. But that's why he did what he did. That's why Jesus Christ did what he did on the cross. That's why he suffered in such a manner. And amen. Praise God for that. So without any further ado, I would like to welcome Mr. Anthony Patch to the program. It's so good to have you back again, Anthony. Thank you so much for joining us.
Oh, my pleasure, Sean. Thank you very much. It's very gracious of you to have me. And like yourself, I am a Christian. Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior, and I profess that on all of my shows as well. And I find what you were stating there to be very educational. Thank you for bringing it up.
Yeah, it's a controversy that's been going around in the church for quite some time. And people ask me what kind of church, you know, where do I go to church? And I've avoided so many of them because of the fact that I hear these antinomian teachings and New Age teachings within the church, and it really bothers me. But I'd like to thank you, first of all, for what you are doing, not only for the faith of Christianity, but also for the truth in exposing some of the things that are going on in the world within this Luciferian agenda. Thank you so much for doing all of that.
Yeah, it is completely my life. It is my calling. It is virtually the only thing that I do. And that's after a process of what I call a stripping away, is my short version of my testimony, literally everything being stripped away in my life. Although I was saved when I was 16, I'm now 63, but back around late 2011, things really changed in my life. And that's where he then set me on the course of taking all of the research that I had been doing for many, many years and made it very clear to me. He said, it's now time for you to start speaking and to start writing about what you've been researching. And that's when he really began to open my eyes up to the occult side of physics, DNA, and quantum computing, which are the three primary areas that I focus on.
Right. And, you know, as far as your testimony goes, and I guess I can kind of relate because I had to figure out once I started realizing what was going on, I thank God every day that there are people a lot smarter than me, like you, who are researching this stuff. You know, I'm just a lowly talk show host, but people refer to what I'm doing as a ministry. And even pastors are saying what you're doing is a ministry. And I guess in some sense of the word, what you are doing and what I am doing and what many other people are doing within the truth movement could be considered as a ministry.
Well, I wholeheartedly agree with that. You don't have to have a church building. You don't have to have a large congregation. In fact, I believe that what you and I are doing on Truth Frequency Radio is building a congregation. We already have a congregation, and it is our responsibility, as it says in Scripture, as God has commanded us. God has commanded us until the return of Jesus Christ to occupy. We're occupiers. We are at work for the Lord, and I am completely consumed and occupied by the work that I'm doing for Him, as I'm sure you are, every waking moment. And even in our sleep. And I think it's important that we keep in mind, you and I, that we are witnesses. I like to refer to myself not as a prophet, certainly not, but more as a reporter. I think that's something that people can, I think, more easily feel comfortable with if they relate to me as a reporter rather than saying, well, I'm a witness or I'm a preacher or that this is my missionary outreach or any of the other typical things you'll find in organized religion. Because like yourself, I don't attend a denominational or non-denominational church. I did for many, many years and tried many different Christian churches, but was left with an unsatisfactory taste in my mouth. And I really think that that, you know, leads to the discussion of the apostasy of the churches today. And this all fits into biblical prophecy in that discussion of apostasy. So I like to make my statements and my answers to questions fairly short. So go right ahead, sir.
Absolutely. Your latest work, Revising Reality, A Biblical Look into the Cosmos, Volume 1. I'm looking forward to Volume 2. Anthony Patch, Josh Peck, Gonzo Shimura, and obviously Douglas Woodward, with an astonishing foreword by Stan Deo. In fact, I just booked Stan Deo on the program. He will be joining us in June after
Excellent.
I come back. After I come back from vacation, I'm really looking forward to that. It's a fabulous book, and it's a must read for Christians and non-Christians, for believers and non-believers. I highly recommend the book. And before we go on here, I'd like to give you an opportunity to tell them where they can get Revising Reality and how they can get a signed copy from you, too.
Well, it's interesting you bring up the autographed aspect of that. My time has become so demanding at this point that I'm, as of actually this morning, I've decided to withdraw that opportunity for an autographed copy. I really just don't have time for order fulfillment, which is what it really comes down to. But certainly through Amazon, or if you go to my website on my homepage, front and center, there's a tab there. You can link directly to Amazon and order a printed copy. They're only $20 plus, I think, about $6 in shipping, and that'll be fulfilled through Amazon for you. The book has done very well. I am honored to be associated with my three co-authors. It's a little different way of presenting material, having a four-way collaboration, but it's been blended together very well. And it takes four specific areas and highlights them for the new Christian, the soon-to-be Christian, or even people that are familiar with some of the areas of science that we go through. But we also go into theology. We go into the, you know, the more traditional Christian topics as well. But it's a very unusual book. The approach we've taken is different than I think you would find in most of the biblical books that are out today.
I got to say, it's a fascinating book. My copy is sitting here, absolutely highlighted to death and dog-eared to death, because I go to it now as a reference. I mean, it is that good. And I'm constantly referring to it, especially your parts when we start talking about CERN and some of the research that you've done into what CERN is doing. And we're going to talk about a lot of things today, but first thing I'd like to ask you about is how CERN works into this end time prophecy, and also how it works into the ancient Tower of Babel. And is there a connection?
Most definitely. CERN represents, quite literally, not figuratively, it represents the new Tower of Babel. It is for the same purpose that the original Nimrod constructed Tower of Babel was built, and that is essentially to reach to heaven. It is the opening of a interdimensional doorway, as CERN themselves have described their activities. Not just recreating the moment of the Big Bang, but openly they state that they want to open a doorway to other dimensions. And in fact, they're not sure what's going to come back through the doorway once they provide or enter or submit something through that doorway themselves to initiate that contact. There have been a number of scientists in and around CERN, Stephen Hawking being one, that have said that we shouldn't be doing this. However, if we refer to Revelation 9, my interpretation of Revelation 9, in which the angel is cast from heaven and is given the key to the bottomless pit, I take the entirety of Revelation 9 as an indicator that CERN will be successful. When? I'm not a prophet, and I don't set dates. But we are definitely in the season, and the technology, as I analyze it, is waiting in the wings. It is ready. They can throw the switch, I think, pretty much any time to open this interdimensional doorway. And out of that, according to Revelation 9, comes the locust army, the demonic spirits, and they rise up through, literally through CERN, because CERN is located over the doorway to the abyss. It is located on the ancient Roman temple site that was built to Apollo, to Apollyon, to Abaddon, the destroyer. And as you may be aware, they also have the statue of Shiva, the Hindu god, representing destruction and rebirth, the rebirthing of a new race, the rebirthing of a new environment, a new universe, right outside the headquarters building at CERN. So there is a spiritual aspect, an occulted aspect to the physics that's taking place at CERN. It's not just simply, you know, they're doing some wonderful experiments. No, there is a dark, nefarious aspect to what is going on. There's more to it, but I always like to have you jump in and I'll just give it to you in chunks.
Yeah, absolutely. And when we come back from the break, we're going to get into much of what Anthony has researched and his writing within Revising Reality. We're going to talk about occulted physics. We're going to talk a lot about this god of Shiva. I mean, that's a big red flag to me. That's some weird stuff. But when we come back from the break, my guest, Anthony Patch, will be joining us and we'll be exploring a lot more of this. So everybody stay tuned. The Awakening Liberty Show will return in just a few minutes.
Initiating the Truth Frequency.
This is Truth Frequency Radio.
I'll bust it one time. Truth and liberty. Fighting the world order and the tyranny. The Awakening Liberty Show is Sean Caron.
And welcome back to segment two, The Awakening Liberty Show, right here on Truth Frequency Radio, all across America, all around the world. The number to call in is 866-26-TRUTH. Again, that number is 866-268-7884. If that one doesn't work for some reason, because we just changed our toll-free line, you can always call in to 213-233-3998. So if you have a question or a comment for myself or my guest, or you have an opinion you'd like to share, that's great. I want to hear it. So feel free to join us. You can also join us in the chat room, one of the best chat rooms in this radio business. I have to say, the TFR people, man, you guys are awesome. And I always like to give a shout out to everybody in the chat room. Today we've got Lucky, Star Lord, my wife Beth, Charles Calvo, Charlie, Lil Juice, Flapping Crow, Three Dogs, Matt Smith, Molly. Some of these names are great, man. Molly Gordon, Sam Ramirez, Simon Wilkins, Thomas Silk, Tony Patch is in there. So again, if you'd like to ask a question, just join us in our chat room. It's real simple to join, either Facebook or Twitter. You can log in. Zella Zapitsky, always a pleasure and an honor to have you guys join me. And it's always a pleasure and an honor to be back behind the microphone every Saturday and Sunday at 2 p.m. Pacific time. Much love and gratitude to you all. My guest today is Anthony Patch, co-author of Revising Reality, A Biblical Look into the Cosmos, of Volume 1, How Dramatic New Discoveries in Biblical Texts and Breakthroughs in Modern Physics Are Transforming Our View of the Cosmos. Absolutely great book. I highly recommend it. Jeff, definitely check it out, Amazon.com, and get this one in your library. It's an essential read, most definitely. Before the break, we were starting to talk a little bit about CERN, and Anthony, you said something that I find very interesting, is that CERN can open this abyss at any time. And with this August 21st eclipse coming up, I mean, are they waiting for a specific cosmological event to open or perform this cosmic jailbreak? Can we talk a little bit about this August 21st eclipse? Because it's got some anomalies surrounding it.
Yeah, definitely. August 21st is very unusual, not just because it is a full eclipse, which doesn't happen all that frequently, but that the pathway of the eclipse itself will traverse the United States from Depot Bay, Oregon, real close to Portland, Oregon, all the way across to South Carolina. And the center line of that shadow will touch upon 10 states. Again, the number 10 obviously is significant. But what's more significant is that the shape of this shadow is in the shape of an egg. And in the Egyptian story, mythology, if you will, those eggs, that egg shape, is known as the Ogdoad. The Ogdoad represents eight, as the name implies, eight godheads, four that are female, four that are male. Half of them are snakes and half of them are frogs. So we're looking at genetics as well here. But this is a harbinger, to sort of borrow from Rabbi Kahn. This is a harbinger because it is an omen, a bad omen, not necessarily for the Jews, as would typically be the case with an eclipse, but for the Gentiles, for, let's say specifically, the United States. I think it is a warning sign to pay attention to what is coming in September, on September 23rd.
And you did a thorough expose on the $4 million coin that was recently heisted in Europe. And it seems to me, as I listened to you talk about that, it certainly made sense that they are making some sort of payment to set this whole thing up. Talk a little bit about that gold coin.
Yeah, the Boat of Ra, which travels through Hades, that is something that requires payment for the dead to traverse hell, traverse Hades, to the more sacred, the better location, if there is one in hell. It is a position of prominence within the dead of hell. And in order to reach that position of prominence, you travel by way of the Boat of Ra, and you have to pay for that boat trip. The thing, it just sounds really bizarre, but if you're looking at mythology, specifically if you're looking within the Egyptian practices, their worship of the dead, you begin to realize that there's a lot more at play within our reality than we are aware of. I often say you cannot separate the spiritual from the physical. So this gold coin was stolen from a Berlin museum. And the name of that museum, among four that are surrounded by water, which is significant in the occult, in the mystical, was Bode, B-O-D-E, the Bode, as in this does not bode well for mankind. Mm-hmm. And this coin, from what I look at in my research, actually was intended to be taken to CERN. And I'll let you jump in there because there's more to add to that.
Yeah, absolutely. And when you look at CERN and the fact that they're trying to open this abyss, and then the fact that this whole, I mean, it, obviously they tried to tell us it was a couple of individuals who actually broke into this place, heavily guarded. Nobody knew anything. No alarms went off. And they took it out in a wheelbarrow, and then there was a burning Mercedes-Benz somewhere close by. This all sounded like a distraction to me.
Yeah, I believe it was taken by boat because that's part of the symbology. That's part of the ritual. I believe because the museum is there, as I said, surrounded by water, that it was spirited away on a boat because it has spiritual connotations to the Boat of Ra. And therefore, yes, the wheelbarrow conveniently left near the railroad tracks and a ladder that was used, and in a nearby parking garage, the burning Mercedes, as you say. This is, I agree with you, a complete distraction. So I'm just posting in chat right now the gold coin, but also the individual, this deity that operates this boat in hell. And this is who receives the payment to transport the dead spirits in hell. Now, what is even more significant is that this is going to lead to resurrection. This gold coin and silver, according to the storyline, is placed within the mouth, within the skull of the dead individual for this payment. And this coin being taken to CERN will be placed with the head of Osiris, the head of Nimrod. Nimrod is in the bloodline of Cain. The actual DNA, the actual head, preserved in a clay jar, surrounded by what they call the sacred fire, which is monoatomic gold. It's called the dust of the pharaohs in the mummification of the pharaohs. They sprinkled the bodies with monoatomic gold. This sacred fire surrounds the DNA, the literal head of Osiris or Nimrod, because Nimrod was cut up into 14 pieces. And it will be placed in the center of the main ring of the Large Hadron Collider. And you have a graphic up in the chat room. The center of that large ring is called the North Area Impact Point. That's where the DNA will be placed for resurrection. And the gold coin facilitates that from the spiritual aspects, as I said, of the boat in Hades.
Wow, that's amazing stuff, and it's a fascinating way to look at all of this. Many people believe that the first Gulf War was, in fact, not really based on what we were told it was. And in fact, when we went back after 9/11, that wasn't based on what we were told it was. In fact, they were actually looking for Nimrod's DNA. Is there any truth to that?
Absolutely correct. That's where the head preserved was taken from the museum in Iraq. And was taken to the Vatican, where it is now. And I believe in September, the Vatican will move it to CERN, because the Jesuit arm, the Black Pope, the Jesuit arm of the Vatican, actually runs CERN. The two principal leaders, both on the scientific and administrative side, are both Jesuits, as are many of the researchers, are Jesuit-schooled physicists and engineers. So this is a Jesuit-driven program, and the question often comes up, well, who's behind all this? Who pays for all this? Well, most of the countries in the world are involved financially, and many of them send their scientists to CERN and also have upwards of 60 or more member states that have laboratories around the world that receive information, data from the experiments at CERN, but also function as proof-of-concept laboratories, putting together the theory into small-scale experiments that are then upscaled once they're sent off to CERN for implementation. So these are a back-and-forth relationship between multiple labs around the world. But this is a spiritual agenda. This has very little to do with physics. The reason that CERN was built as the Tower of Babel is the process of this opening of a doorway, but it is also the process of the resurrection of the dead, and the resurrection requires the gold. And there's a whole background to that in terms of Enochian mathematics and language, communicating with fallen angels, obtaining forbidden knowledge, the forbidden knowledge obtained by Dee and Kelly and up through, as you mentioned earlier, Aleister Crowley, Jack Parsons, JPL, all the way up to today with D-Wave Corporation's interdimensional quantum computers and CERN and the work in genetic modification, genetic research, is all for the purpose of achieving immortality, the original lie in the Garden of Eden.
Yeah, absolutely. And as a caveat, you know, I was schooled by the Jesuits, and I was schooled so well, in fact, in hindsight, I look back at the way they schooled me. I was really indoctrinated into scientism. And I almost, as now I actually look back at that and say, this was all by design, was to actually make me walk away from God, because I did. I left the church. I took off on my own search for truth. And I really believe that that's what they're doing in obviously, through everything that we see, is indoctrinating people into this whole scientist thing and then preparing people for sites like 2045.com, where there's a mortality button, immortality button. I don't know if you've seen that. In fact, I'll try to find that and put it up in the chat room. But that's what they're trying to do. And then the Jesuits certainly have a sordid past obviously being the military arm of the Vatican. But not only are they the military arm, but they are the, would you characterize them as the satanic side of the Vatican?
Yes, hence the name the Black Pope, who is the Jesuit general, who is, let's call him, the strong arm of the Vatican structure itself and very much behind the scenes. And this is what is being utilized. This is the bureaucratic structure, if you will, of what is running CERN.
Wow. And then obviously you said so many nations are involved. Are these nations being coerced or are they complicit? Do they actually know what's going on?
Oh, yeah, they're totally complicit in this. We know that Satan is the one who is running humanity. I mean, he does it according to God's will and God's plan, and God allows this. But yes, our reality is operated through Satan and the worship of Lucifer. And these are worshipers of Lucifer, the leadership within each country that sets their agenda and sets their participation in this. Lucifer has deceived these people. I don't have anything against these individual people, Vatican, Jesuit, physicists, engineers, you know, political leaders, because they've been deceived. And I am concerned for their souls because of this deception. But they're following the lies of the father of lies, Lucifer. And all of this information, as I said earlier, is obtained through communication with fallen angels. And this is the outgrowth of that communication. And to be somewhat specific about that, what they're obtaining in terms of information is mathematical information, equations, algorithms, formulas. This is what spawned the whole transmutation of metals. The alchemy in today's science is nothing more than a fancy version of alchemy. But literally, they are going through the alchemic process of creating artificial DNA for the purpose of merging that artificial construct of DNA, what I call in silico, in the computer design DNA, the merging of that DNA at CERN with the spirits that will be released when that doorway to the abyss is opened.
Another question for you here when it comes to CERN, and there's a part in you talk about in Revising Reality, the Electric Universe, speaking of the golden age of Kronos, and I started making some connections in my own head with the gold coin, Saturn. Is there a connection there as well?
Most definitely. Saturn is Satan, and he is worshipped. Saturn is worshipped all through Greek and Roman mythology. This is all part of the astrological process. In fact, the black cube that is worshipped at Mecca is seen throughout the world. The worship of the black cube even pervades and invades all of our alphabet agencies that you talked about at the introduction of your show. This has been confirmed to me that they are all about the worship of a black cube within Saturn itself. It represents a prison. Saturn is a prison planet. This black cube holds their leadership, their deity, and CERN's connection quite literally is that they will produce an electric current known as Birkeland currents, which have been photographed by Hubble, light years in length, that look exactly like the twisted pair of human DNA, a twisted helix. CERN will produce Birkeland currents, an electrical pathway that will connect Earth to the southern pole of Saturn, and thus unlocking the prison planet black cube within and releasing and then allowing for transport of those spirits from Saturn that they worship back to Earth. It's what I call a plasma conduit, because in the electric model of the universe, the so-called vacuum of space is actually comprised and filled with ionized gas, a plasma, the fourth state of matter. And it is a conductive medium which will allow this plasma conduit to, one, unlock that prison and then allow the transporting, if you will, of these spirits back to Earth. And this is a concurrent process to the opening of the doorway to the abyss, the unlocking of this black prison, the black cube of Mecca, and this merging, this resurrection of DNA. These are all concurrent events that happen in the center point, the north impact area of the main ring of the Large Hadron Collider at CERN.
Will Nimrod, when resurrected, will he take the form of the Antichrist or the position of the Antichrist?
I believe so. I believe that this speaks to, and again, I'm not setting dates, but we are seeing the sign of the birthing of the Antichrist spirit in Revelation 12 on September 23rd. Does it mean something's going to happen on September 23rd? Not necessarily. It could, but it could also simply be another one of those signs in the heavens that we're commanded to pay attention to the sun, the moon, and the stars, not from an astrological standpoint, but as signs of the season. So yes, Nimrod will take on that role as the Antichrist, because the Antichrist, the spirit of the Antichrist, will be released, I believe, during this event of the birthing of Jupiter. It could just be symbolism to the birthing of that spirit, but it could also be the actual event of the releasing of that spirit to Earth, as described in Revelation 12.
And you refer to, in Revising Reality, as into what I referred to earlier, as a cosmic jailbreak. They are trying to essentially open the abyss and free all that were imprisoned there by God after the flood and the antediluvian age. So, essentially, they're creating a cosmic jailbreak.
Absolutely, they are. And again, this is reflected in the hieroglyphs in Egypt and also in the Sumerian tablets and the writings. This has always been the agenda, is to replace God's creation with what Lucifer believes is his creation. Of course, Lucifer, Satan, cannot create anything. Only God is able to do that through Jesus Christ. However, what we're looking at here is the typical scenario in which in Scripture it says that, you know, Satan will turn everything upside down. He also turns it 180 degrees around on a horizontal configuration, if you think in terms of how mirrors play such a significant role in the mystical world. This is a mirror image process of God's creation. What Satan wants to do is to eliminate God's creation and replace it with his own. His own is, number one, the dead, the spirits of the dead. And then this artificial construct of a human 2.0, if you will, through artificial DNA. DNA that starts at the quantum level through quantum mechanics, quantum physics, is designed and actually grown. If you want to call it 3D printing, that's one scenario you can look at. There's a lot more I can give you in terms of details. I'm just hitting the bullet points. The idea here is that he wants to eliminate the living and replace it with the dead.
Yeah, I find it interesting in Revelations, it talks about, in multiple places in the Bible, it talks about in the end of days, there will be those who seek death, but death will avoid them. Are we talking about the transhumanist agenda here and in replacing, obviously, the God-created physical body, the God-created soul, with some sort of AI?
Yes, that's the cruel reality that it will be facing those, let's call them the elite, just for the sake of discussion, the cruel reality that they will awaken to, those that choose to be involved in this transhumanist movement. Now, to break that down a little bit more finely, transhumanism, most people think of uploading your consciousness into a computer. We are way beyond that in technology. What we're talking about is actually creating artificial DNA and artificial intelligence that then the consciousness and the memories will be loaded into, let's just call it a hybrid, just to make it simple, loaded into this artificial body and this artificial mind. So it's not being loaded into a computer as you would think, you know, in a laboratory, some hardware. We're talking about what I would call warm and wet qubits within the construct of an artificial brain, a living tissue that is actually built. And I can give you more details on that as well. But we're talking about an actual brain that models the human brain and an actual body that models the human body, again, human 2.0. And it will be 4 or 5 months, immortal. But they will wish that they were not immortal, as scripture indicates, and as you just said.
Yeah, that is a big red flag for me when I start looking at that and realizing that that technology does exist today. There are also those who believe that what's going on with the environment, with the global warming hoax, scam, reality, whatever you want to call it, the chemtrails, obviously they're corrupting our soils, the genetically modified foods, obviously they're manipulating DNA as in the days of Noah. Are they in fact trying to terraform this planet for Lucifer, the Lucifer's world?
Absolutely. You hit it right on the head. In fact, that's a phrase or a term that I've used many times, is terraforming the planet, because CERN has physical implications for the planet and the magnetosphere, our shields, but the aerosolized brain, the chemtrails, are loaded, as you well know, with heavy metals, aluminum, barium, strontium, desiccated red blood cells, human blood cells, lithium is a big component. These are all to change the atmosphere, the environment for this new race of beings that is so openly promoted in popular culture to ascend to this new race of beings. And they are designing a new environment that will not support human 1.0, but will support human 2.0. And as you see in scripture, we know that at least a third of mankind will be killed off, and that's reflected in their own Georgia Guidestones. So this is the death of humanity as God has created it, and the birthing, the resurrection of the dead as Satan sees it. And the other aspect to the terraforming is within the aerosolized brain are nanoparticles that are dormant that will form a third strand of DNA once they are activated through the 5G Wi-Fi system that we are fully immersed in throughout the planet now. That 5G, if through free will you choose to take the mark of the beast, that will activate, the 5G will activate the dormant nanoparticles within all of us and begin to replicate this third strand of DNA, thus plugging you into the sentient world simulation, SWS, which is a digital reality that is operated by D-Wave's quantum computers, which are interdimensional computers. And this will then plug you into that matrix, into that hive mentality. We're already part of the sentient world simulation in the sense that we are being monitored. Every person, 7 billion plus people, are represented within this Purdue University program, SWS, represented as a node and given an avatar, and we are monitored and thus providing algorithms of human behavior, algorithms as to how our brains operate, to the deep machine learning of the AI system that is continually learning about us and how we behave and how we think, so as to increase the capabilities of the AI system that operates the sentient world simulation.
Hold that thought, Tony. When we come back, I want to ask you about the Internet of Things and how that relates to all of this end time prophecy as well, and what you're talking about, mass surveillance. The Awakening Liberty Show with my guest, Tony Patch. We'll be right back.
Truth Frequency Radio.
The Wicked Ones, obviously under heavy Masonic influence.
Ha 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 ha! Hi, everyone. This is Sean from the Awakening Liberty Show. Are you and your family prepared for an emergency? Have you ever thought about investing in food and water storage? Well, if you have, I urge you to check out my one-stop prepper shop. AwakeningLibertyStore.com carries the full line of Legacy Premium, non-GMO, made-in-USA emergency food storage and survival gear. Folks, I've tried them all, and Legacy Premium is the best I've found. Boasting the lowest cost per pound, the lowest cost per calorie, and the largest serving size in the industry, Legacy Premium is simply the best. Not to mention it was voted best tasting in blind taste tests, and I personally concur. Shop AwakeningLibertyStore.com and use coupon code PATRIOT for a special listener discount, or call me personally at 775-276-4046. Once again, AwakeningLibertyStore.com. And we are back, hour number two of the Awakening Liberty Show right here on truthfrequencyradio.com, your protection from deception. As always, this hour is brought to you by dcwebdesigns.net. Stop by and say hi to Dave Christensen over there. He designed the awakeninglibertyshow.com website. You can stop by and check it out. Awesome site. He did a great job. If you need a website for a podcast or a small business, whatever you're looking for, Dave Christensen at dcwebdesigns.net can help you build it. And he does a great job. Absolutely. I fully endorse him. Also, Future Dan over at futuredanger.com and his heat map indicator news system. Stop by and check it out at futuredanger.com. I definitely like his stuff. He does a lot of work. I know he's constantly scouring the news to figure out what's fake and what's true. And in this world of fake news, we all got to be discerning. There's that word CERN. Discerning the truth is a very difficult thing to do, to say the least. Also, awakeninglibertystore.com. Stop by, check it out. We got a great big sale going on. May Day Madness. Use coupon code MAYDAY. Again, that's coupon code MAYDAY at checkout and receive 15% off your entire order. We have the largest selection and the best chef-developed emergency food storage in the business, non-GMO, made in USA, along with a whole bunch of other survival gear. We've got probiotics. We've got health and wellness from Longevity. We also have the new Ilio solar backup generator system. It's incredibly expandable, lightweight and modular solution for power outages, long-term emergencies, outdoor activities, whatever you want to use it for. If you're in need of power in a pinch, there's no better solution than the Ilios 1100. We've got four different models to choose from, perfect for powering laptops, cell phones, household appliances, lights, tablets, TVs, and more. I mean, in the RV or out in the great outdoors. In fact, I just ordered one. We're going to be using it as well, as we've been kind of thinking, I don't know, with everything going on these days, we might cut and run. We might sell the house, buy a fifth wheel, or go up in the mountains and build a bunker. I don't know. But my guest today is Anthony Patch, and we're talking about CERN. We've covered so much here, and I have got a whole sheet of paper here with questions and quick little notes, because everything we're talking about fascinates me. And Anthony's work with Revising Reality, go to Amazon.com, get Revising Reality, A Biblical Look into the Cosmos, Volume 1. Definitely looking forward to Volume 2. Anthony Peck, Josh Peck, Anthony Patch, Josh Peck, Gonzo Shimura, and S. Douglas Woodward. It's a must read. It's essential. Put this in your library and study it, because what we're facing today is definitely, I don't know, as in the days of Noah. And I wanted to ask you, Anthony, obviously we know from Gen 6, post-diluvian, antediluvian, that there was a corruption of all human flesh, that there was an intermingling of the gene pool of some sort, and God seemed to correct that with the flood and the giants and the Nephilim and the sons of God and all this stuff. Are we living in the days of Noah again? Is that one of the biggest end-time prophetic markers that we should be looking at?
I wholeheartedly believe that we are. I think that we have very little time left. Defining that is difficult, but we certainly see the markers within the research that I do, the DNA markers, pardon the pun. But again, if you look at how they have advanced with DNA research, we look at things like the CRISPR machine, which is basically a gene splicing tool, but we go deeper in that to DNA sequencing. I've often referred to the research of Dr. Craig Venter and his Institute for Human Longevity in La Jolla, California. He's really one of the cornerstones in DNA sequencing. DNA sequencing was a program that was run out of Berkeley with a laboratory close to Berkeley, UC Berkeley in Walnut Creek, where they set up a genome lab. But we go deeper than just mapping the pattern of the DNA. We go right down to the quantum level. DNA sequencing, the patterns of DNA genomes, was done with particle accelerators, just like at CERN. Berkeley has a small ring-based synchrotron particle accelerator, and there they generate what are known as hard X-rays. Those were used initially for inferring the shape of the complex interweaving, if you will, of the proteins of DNA, and then the ability to 3D model those proteins. Going even deeper than that, however, I'm being very brief here, they have been able to use particle accelerators for the purpose of looking at the quantum scale of DNA. And as I said earlier, in silico, in the computer, actually being able to arrange the quantum particles in their own design and pattern, their own sequence, to create their own sequence of DNA. Now we go back to my discussion of Enoch, the Enochian language, the mathematics that were being provided to those that were accessing the fallen angels, which is what D-Wave is continuing to do with interdimensional quantum computing. They are continually receiving information from the fallen angels through the D-Wave computers. But with those computers, they have been able to obtain the geometric arrangement of quantum particles, the actual equations and algorithms with which they use as a pattern to describe the arrangement of quantum particles to then build the DNA within the computer and then use that as the pattern for a new race of beings. So that's the short version.
Yeah, CRISPR and Cas9, that whole thing just is spooky to say the least. And because they are certainly messing with our human genome, they're messing with human DNA. And, you know, we're very careful, Tony, about what we put into our bodies. Because, you know, I'm so concerned about the genetically modified foods, the genetically modified organisms. I'm concerned about fluoride. I'm concerned about pharmacological drugs. And I want to make this inference because there's this theory that's going around in my head, because obviously many people who listen to my show know I am deeply involved within the vaccine truth movement. And what that's doing to people, number one, it's creating a whole generation. We're talking 2032 vaccination rates. And autism rates are going to be 1 in 2 in 80% of boys, affecting their ability to critically think. And we know that the elite basically want slaves. They want us to not be able to rebel. They want to formulate our mindset and our beliefs into such a manner where we won't be able to rebel against what is coming. And I believe that to be certainly the Luciferian agenda. But vaccinations, this has come to me just recently when I start looking at them based on the fact that they can be manipulating people's DNA, RFID chips, all this kind of thing, that this may actually be part of the beast system or the mark of the beast system. Your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I don't disagree with you. If we just look at the effects of mercury being used as a preservative within these vaccines, that alone is a neurotoxin, as you're well aware. I'm just sharing that with the audience. But yes, this is for the building of the surf class. This is for making it culturally fashionable to be part of the hive mentality through technology. And in not taking the mark of the beast, we become the enemy. By not participating in technology, we become the enemy. By not taking the vaccines and vaccinating our children who want to attend school but are locked out because they are somehow posing a risk to other children because they're not vaccinated, become the enemy. And this is all spoken of and reflected in scripture. So my position for many years, and I am a retired paramedic out of Oakland, 27 years working the streets of Oakland, very familiar with medicine at that level and vaccines. And I have always, even with my own children, have said, no, the vaccines pose too great a risk. This is all part of the larger agenda of not only creating a surf class of people who, as you said, lack the ability to have critical thinking skills. Something that I've advocated on all my shows is for people to think critically. But it is the creating of a crisis in which people will then demand the cure. So if we want to talk about the Ebola scenarios, which is an artificial construct, any of these euthanasia type situations, or the reduction of population because they want to weed out the less than desirable. This is part of what Bill Gates is involved in, just as his father was. If we're looking at the reduction of population, they can do that through the vaccination programs by creating a false pandemic in which then people demand the vaccine and then they're done for. So go ahead.
Absolutely clamor for it. When you look at the Greek words, when it talks about the mark of the beast, that people may be given or may be forced. But when you really dig into the Greek, it looks like it could be accepted or received or placed upon. And the received part is what got me when I started looking at the at these words, because people are all too accepting today of pharmacological medicine. They are all too accepting of science. And I got to commend you on being a paramedic. That's where medicine rises to the top, because trauma surgeons, paramedics, they know what they're doing at the time. It doesn't have anything to do with pharmacological drugs, which I believe are absolutely dangerous. I got all the faith in the world in trauma surgeons and paramedics, like I said, but not in pharmacological medication. I think there's a big danger there as well. When it comes to obviously implementing a global population reduction, or somebody just posted a shot of Bill Gates in the chat room. You know, this guy is evil personified, as was David Rockefeller. And I posted the dancing Snoopy when David Rockefeller died. I wonder if he really even died. I wonder if they just transferred his consciousness to a computer or something.
I would imagine that they have. And in fact, you know, what was he, 100 years old, 101 when he died?
Yeah.
I mean, how does a guy live that long that obviously doesn't look like, you know, he's too buff. He doesn't look like he takes care of himself.
No, and but, he had like 6 heart transplants.
Yeah, I mean, this is, and it goes into the whole discussion, disgusting discussion of pedophilia and the blood of children and the blood of umbilical cords and T cells. And it's just really bizarre. But I wanted to mention about Bill Gates, and Gordy Rose was posted in the chat room by my friend Rebecca. We look at guys like Gates, we look at Steve Jobs, who's obviously deceased now. We look at Elon Musk. We look at the leaders in technology today. And you have to ask yourself, for example, specifically to D-Wave, Gordy Rose, you have to ask yourself, how do you, in the late 1990s, have transistor-based gate model computers proliferating the planet on various scales? And then all of a sudden, right after 9/11, we see the advent of quantum bits known as qubits and D-Wave. And now we're talking about computers that have the equivalent processing power of 7 billion human brains and are accessing, back in 2013, Gordy Rose citing their then model 512 qubits as accessing 2 to the 500th power of parallel dimensions. When I said that this is an Enochian communications tool, I mean that literally, and they do as well, because Gordy Rose said, as the picture in chat indicates here, he made the statement, which you'll find at my website. If you go to anthonypatch.com, go to my Urgent Discoveries tab, I have several quotes from 2013, a video in which he says, when you stand next to one of these, he's referring to the black cube computer, it sounds eerily like a heartbeat, and it feels like an altar to an alien god. And he says, when they're accessing these parallel dimensions, thousands of them, quite literally now we're at the point of almost infinite numbers of parallel dimensions. He said, if we are smart enough, we're clever enough, we can reach into these parallel dimensions and extract resources from those parallel dimensions. This is all the communication as reflected in Enochian mathematics and the Enochian alphabet that is ongoing in the present time, 24/7, using these computers. And the computers are sold to Google, Amazon, NSA, Lockheed Martin, USC, and latest model, the 2000Q, 2000-qubit computer, was sold to Temporal Defense Systems, which is purely there for the purpose of cryptological communications. Now, there's a lot more I can say. I want you to jump in here, but we are talking about interdimensional communications with fallen angels, as exemplified in the quantum computers, the modification of DNA, and the particle accelerator at CERN.
There's no denying that technology has exponentially progressed. It's beyond even our human comprehension at this point, into the fact that, and what I'm thinking here is, and correct me if I would be wrong, but is our technology, what we are experiencing today, even what we're doing sitting here in front of these computers with this VOIP technology, is this technology, has it all come from communication with fallen angels?
Yes. People want to say, in the scenario of, like, you know, UFOs are a big topic of discussion right now. And your friend, my friend, L.A. Marzulli, commend him on his research that he's ongoing presently with UFOs. But, you know, this reverse engineering of Area 51, a crash that, you know, occurred and all this, that reverse engineering, let's go back into history. Let's go back into talking about Nostradamus. Let's talk about the Egyptians. Let's talk about the Sumerians and Babylonians. This has been going on since the Garden of Eden. This original Adamic communications, this language of communication with fallen angels, has been going on all through history. And what we are seeing is the physical, tangible, most modern results of that. See, Kelly indeed did not have the ability to build a particle accelerator or to modify DNA. They could transmutate things like lead into gold because they had the monoatomic gold. They had the particulate gold that existed in quartz predominantly. If we go to the discussion of Prague, and there's a whole another story about Prague and all of the, you know, monoatomic gold that's there that was used by Dee and Kelly and others like him for the transmutation. They started with gold, monoatomic. But the whole point I'm getting at here is that there's been a progression of information and a progression of technology. And we are now at the zenith, which is represented as the days of Noah, because quite literally, every imagination of man will be allowed under the plan and control of God, but only to a point in time in which God and Jesus Christ will return and judgment will befall, just as in the days of Noah will befall those that have turned their attention and their worship to Lucifer.
And the reward lies in the fact, and I always go back to Genesis 6, and in the fact that the reward for us as humanity by choosing God as opposed to this Luciferian agenda goes back to Genesis 6, in the fact that God had intended to elevate mankind above the angels. The angels felt snubbed. They got a little ticked off, thus the rebellion. Yes?
Agreed. This is Nimrod's agenda. Nimrod's agenda was to ascend to the heavens, to sit on the throne of God. In other words, in the way I put it, in more, let's say, more modern terms, is Nimrod wants to kill God and his angels. Nimrod is following the same agenda as Lucifer. Lucifer being, you know, the most beautiful angel in heaven. In his hubris, believes that he can kill God and his angels. And that's why we see in Scripture this warfare in the heavens, the warfare between the angels, because Nimrod wants to ascend to the throne by killing God and his angels. And the technology he has built is all weapons technology. And this goes off into a whole discussion of strangelets that just was confirmed last week that I've been talking about for 3 years that CERN will be producing, and it's been confirmed through CERN's own press release last week. I did a whole show on this. The most explosive substance in the known universe, they have confirmed that they are producing at CERN, along with kinetic energy weapons and directed energy weapons. CERN has always been a weapons program. It has always been about opening the portal and the release, the resurrection of the dead, but the simultaneous side-by-side agenda is the killing of God.
Absolutely, and I believe that's what the agenda is, not only with things like CERN, but absolutely everywhere else that we look, within Hollywood, within the music industry, with scientism, that they basically want us to all believe we are a freak of nature from some cosmic goo in some far-off corner of the galaxy, and that we are not special, and that there is no creator. They are essentially trying to kill God in that manner as well. And that leads to my questions about the Awake experiment. Could, first of all, explain what the Awake experiment is.
Yeah, briefly, it is a straight line particle accelerator, a linear accelerator. Overall, it's 30 meters in length. The actual chamber where the plasma that they're employing in this accelerator is 10 meters in length. This is conjoined to the 27 kilometer long main ring, 300 feet below ground at CERN. They have merged the ring-based accelerator to the straight line accelerator for the purpose of producing 20 peta electron volts, not tera electron where they've been operating at, but the linear accelerator combined with the main ring, the LHC, is to direct 20 peta electron volts of accelerated particles at the north area impact point in the center of this main ring. And a ring, a circle, is always used in witchcraft, okay? It's always used in rituals. CERN is a ritual. It is built according to the Enochian and Kelly and Dee received information, the pattern of the circle with the four cardinal points, which is where each of the main detectors of CERN are located on the circle at four cardinal points. And the center point is where the energy from Awake will be directed for the opening of the portal, first at the quantum scale by separating quarks and gluons, which are strangelets, separating quantum particles with this energy to tear the veil, to open this interdimensional portal that I describe as a macro scale portal, the freeway allowing the free movement of these spirits into our reality, thus permanently revising it. So Awake will, it began calibrations November of last year. It's been shut down. May 8th, it will start back up. It will run all the way through into December. Awake on May 8th doesn't necessarily mean anything's going to happen. It doesn't mean they're opening the portal on May 8th. It just means they're going to begin their experiments with Awake. This is a plasma Wakefield accelerator, a complete departure from the main ring itself.
I find that fascinating in the fact that, first of all, they call it Awake when we have this whole awakening. You know, this term is stereotypical. It's being blasted around everywhere on the net that everybody's going to wake up to this higher consciousness, this whole new age mentality. And then we have the truth movement talking about coming awake. I don't see any coincidence that they named it that, but could Awake, the Awake experiment, also be used when Jesus Christ returns, when God does come back, to obviously bring humanity and elevate them into the thousand years of peace spoken about in the Bible? Could it be used as a weapon against him?
Oh, most definitely. Absolutely. It is a kinetic energy as well as a directed energy machine. It's a weapon because plasma is the fourth state of matter. It's neither solid nor gas. It is neither a particle nor a wave. It's all of those at the same time in the fourth state. Most definitely, this is a weapons program that they intend to use to kill the Holy Spirit. That's the extent of the hubris of these people that are involved, that they are so deceived into believing that they will achieve, their reward will be this immortality if they are successful with their weapons program. Totally agree with you.
It's absolutely crazy. I mentioned earlier the Internet of Things, and if we need to, we'll carry on into the next segment. But there's a company coming here into Nevada here just recently. They just actually said they were going to build, called Internet of Things. And we were talking about the surveillance and the fact that through all of this computer technology and the fact that we're obviously being listened to by the NSA, what are your thoughts on the Internet of Things?
Well, this is all an extension and a further immersion into the sentient world simulation. Now, this isn't something that I made up. 2006, the white paper from Purdue was published, peer-reviewed, creating this artificial construct of our environment within quantum computers. And it went live in 2007. And its development has moved lockstep with the development of D-Wave's advancing models of quantum computers, employing more and more, quantum bits. What we talk about, the Internet of Everything, is essentially everything is now a sensor. If you think of the detectors at CERN that are measuring the spin, the trajectory, the energies, the identities, the masses of quantum particles, the same thing is being done with the Internet of Things. These are all sensors feeding information into the artificially intelligent sentient world simulation. It's not just monitoring, but it is deep machine learning. It is teaching the AI, and I know we're about to go to break, so we'll pick it up on the other side when we talk about how does the AI learn from human beings.
Absolutely, man. This is a fascinating discussion. Everybody stay tuned. The Awakening Liberty Show with my guest, Anthony Patch. We'll be right back.
Truth Frequency Radio.
No hate, no hype, no fear. Real people, real radio.
I bust it one time. Truth and liberty. Fighting the world order and the tyranny. The Awakening Liberty Show with Sean Caron.
And welcome back to the Awakening Liberty Show right here on truthfrequencyradio.com, your protection from deception. We'll open up the phone lines this segment. If you do have a question or a comment for myself or for my guests, feel free to join us. My guest today is Anthony Patch, and we're talking about CERN. We're talking about biblical prophecy and markers of the end times. Fascinating discussion. It's just blown by here. And we've covered so much. But in the last segment, we were talking about the Internet of Things, the Internet of Everything. And let's continue that discussion because of what they are doing. And then I want to talk a little bit about biometrics briefly.
Certainly. Again, this is a process. The Internet of Everything is a process of just feeding more information to the artificially intelligent system. And this system is built by D-Wave. They have numerous models of these computers, but I have identified 12. There are more, but I don't release the actual number. Pardon me. But there are 12 models that they have. The 10th model achieved the equivalent processing power in terms of the number of qubits that it has as being equivalent to the number of tubulin dimers within the neuron of the human brain. There's a one-to-one correlation at the 10th model that has 65,536 qubits in it. This is not public information. This is information that I've dug up myself. But at that level, the sentient world simulation AI system was a match that they have now exceeded with two subsequent models and more. So we are talking about a system, the Internet of Everything, that feeds information into this AI computer system, so that it learns how our brain functions. It actually mimics the physical construct and the materials, but then the processes beyond just mapping the human brain like they did with the human DNA. It's learning the algorithms, because our brains are actually quantum computers down at the tubulin dimer binary pair level, which then forms microtubules, which forms our neurons, is a quantum computer. And so with their quantum computer, they had to have a one-to-one match. So to program it, it's called deep machine learning. They observe through the internet how we think, how we operate. When you see things like Gotham Shield or Jade Helm, these are all psychological operations to test our reactions so the machine can learn. If you go back to the origin of D-Wave and how they first programmed their computers, it was all about observing human behavior. So I'll stop there.
Yeah, I think 9/11 was the same type of psyop, and they certainly got a lot of information from them. I'd like to mention also that my guest Anthony Patch is a host on Truth Frequency Radio, and you can catch his show every Friday from 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. I believe that's Pacific time?
It's 4 to 6, and that is, what is that? Is that, that's 4 to 6 my time, which is Central time.
Right, so that's 2 p.m. to 4 p.m., the Anthony Patch Show. Everybody tune into his show and support his efforts as well. He's a fascinating individual. I just love having you on the show, Tony. It's an honor to have you here. When we're talking about the way how does like biometrics and this whole Internet of Things tie into Agenda 2030 and the Beast System? Is this how they are going to, number one, be able to, we have the technology now to pinpoint every human being on the planet unless they move into the jungle somewhere. But, you know, and even then, who knows, especially if they've had a vaccine or taken a pharmacological drug. I don't know what's in this stuff. But sure. The Agenda 2030 and biometrics and the Internet of Things, is this all tied into this whole beast system?
It totally is, because it's a network. Quite literally, it is a network. We talk about the World Wide Web. That's literally what it is. It literally connects our DNA to the sentient world simulation and the quantum computers. And this may be written off as hyperbole by people listening to this, but understand that the things that I do involve reading their own papers. I go way back into history and look at their papers, and I move forward and I can extrapolate and not predict, but I can see the applications in the future time of their origins of their technology. If you look at things like DARPA, which is real easy to cite as an example, D-Wave, for example, came out of DARPA. $10 million of seed money from DARPA formed D-Wave Corporation, and then it went to venture capital at $20 million. But the point here is that biometrics is feeding information through this network so that the network can monitor and thus control every single person on the planet, because it all boils down to control. That's what biometrics are there for. When they start talking about all these advances in technology and their applications into medical technology for the curing of diseases and the correction of birth defects, that's all to make it look warm and fuzzy.
Right.
The real reason is to create the serf class and control it.
Yeah, that's the whole ruse for the betterment of humanity. And folks, as Anthony so eloquently put, this is not conspiracy. I mean, the World Bank themselves have been calling on governments to work together to implement standardized, cost-effective identity management solutions. I mean, they are talking about this by using biometric technologies. By 2030, they want a legal ID in the hands of everybody, and I'm not so sure it'll be in the hands. But it is absolutely crazy. And then Ray Kurzweil, he mentions that nanobots in our brains by the 2030s will make us godlike. I mean, this isn't conspiracy. They themselves are talking about this, and especially through Agenda 2030, because they are calling for it. The United Nations is calling for this type of stuff. It's absolutely crazy to me. I want to ask you a little bit about Revelation 13, because it has proven to be one of the deepest and most contemplated biblical mysteries in the Bible, and especially around people who have studied the apocalypse and Armageddon and all of that stuff. Obviously, it talks about 666. I'm trying to find it here. All be marked on their foreheads. But it's very interesting. Let the person who has insight calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. That number is 666, Revelation 13, verse 18, I believe. Very interesting to me. And I had a guest here on recently, and I've been doing some more research into the 666 number and the fact how it relates to carbon 12. Do you have any knowledge of all that?
Well, I'm not an expert, but I have some background in it. Were you speaking with Derek Gilbert, by the way?
Carl Gallup's, Pastor Carl Gallup's.
Oh, yeah, I know. Yeah, I know his work. Yeah, carbon 12 is the most prolific of the elements in our known universe. It basically is the basis for assigning the atomic masses for all of the other elements. Carbon 12, when, you know, like in Star Trek, they often refer to the carbon-based life form. This is what they're speaking of. But there's also, as I shared with you before the show began, there's also C60 carbon. C60 is carbon. C60 and C12. C12 carbon, being the most predominant, has 6 neutrons, 6 protons, and 6 electrons. These are all the components. The 3 primary components of an atom. And therefore, you build out from there into your molecules. But I always like to go below the atomic scale and always get into the funnier labels of, in terms of quantum particles. But suffice for this discussion, if we look at 666 being the electrons, protons, and neutrons that form the carbon that then is assigned as the foundation for our life form, it's easy to extrapolate that and assume that the 666, the name of man, the identification of man, being carbon 12. And I think it's fantastic to do that because we can always take scripture and overlay it onto the world of modern science.
Yeah. And, you know, when I started looking into that, it just blows me away because it almost already seems it is the number of man. And what it says that let he who hath understanding reckon the number. And only up until recently has humanity realized that carbon 12, and obviously at the protons and the neuron levels and the electron levels, we have finally come to the ability to reckon that number and to figure out that it is the number of man.
That is true. And again, it goes back to the whole discussion of the Enochian communication with fallen angels. There's been this progression of man's ability to comprehend what is going on in the world of nature, so to speak, in the secular vernacular. And so it is this rapid advancement. Once we got to the point of being able to understand the information and experiment with the information to then begin to build machines that would confirm the information to us. I mentioned the geometric arrangement of quantum particles. We're now looking at the geometric arrangement of the atoms and then the arrangement of molecules. All of this is based upon mathematics that have been communicated. And therefore, you build the machines to then confirm the math. And once you confirm the math with your machines, you can then advance into sequencing and carbon splicing and genetic modification and building models of DNA within the computer.
And the chimera from ancient times, I mean, the Bible talks about dragons and it talks about even unicorns and fairies. I mean, were these all the same type of things? I mean, were they using the same technology back then?
Not the same technology. Where we have shifted is away from the spiritual manipulation of DNA. And we can get deeper and define what I mean by spiritual. But we moved, even with the Tower of Babel scenario, we moved from spiritual machinery, so to speak, to hands-on nuts and bolts machinery. Because after the Tower of Babel, mankind, the human race, lost that advanced spiritual manipulation of reality, specifically our DNA in this conversation. Now, the dependence upon or the ability to use the spiritual manipulation was done away with, not entirely, but certainly minimized. And the replacement of that, the necessity of replacement, were nuts and bolts technology. That was the frustration of Nimrod. That was when his spiritual tower was destroyed. He had to find a replacement. The replacement is technology of today.
Right. You know, and I want to digress for just a second because I feel the need, as I do in most shows, to talk about the vaccination issue. And I want to tell everybody, please think once, think twice, think three times, educate before you vaccinate, because I don't know if God's talking through me or if I'm receiving something from him, but something about the vaccinations is really bothering me. And because it's becoming so pervasive and they're trying to mandate it. But I just wanted to mention that again, because I get chills every time I talk about what we are talking about today. But let's talk a little bit about Tesla. Now, Einstein was reportedly to have been asked, what's it like to be the smartest man in the world? And Einstein responded, I don't know. You'll have to ask Tesla.
I love that. And it's interesting, in popular culture on Discovery Channel, they just started a series on Einstein. So they're holding him out as, you know, almost like a godlike figure, when in fact the real technology, even reflected at CERN, and you mentioned the awake plasma accelerator, that's all Tesla. Everything that is going on with CERN is Tesla. And that all rolls over into the modification of DNA because of the use of the particle colliders and the energy derived from it, specifically X-rays. And then it goes all into the discussion of quantum computing. All of that came from Tesla. I'm going to give you the very short version, because Tesla, basically, I'm paraphrasing, said that if you understand the relationship of 369, you will have the key to unlocking the universe. 369 goes to, in geometry, the tetrahedron. And I understand you have a background with Buckminster Fuller, as I do. And Buckminster Fuller said that the simplest geometric form that can enclose a volume is the tetrahedron. The tetrahedron I just spoke about a few shows ago with Kev Baker, in which I demonstrated the tetrahedron, when laid out in a two-dimensional form, is the relationship of 369. 369 is the building block, the singularity, the starting point of the universe. It is not a big bang. It is a rapid expansion of replicating, self-replicating tetrahedrons. This is why it has been observed and confirmed in the cosmos through astronomical observation that Buckminster Fullerenes, buckyballs, tetrahedral buckyballs, make up the structure of the cosmos. And therefore, I put together my model of the universe, as Rebecca put up in chat. The 600-cell tetrahedron is a snapshot of this rapid replication of tetrahedrons moving outward and forming our universe. It is not a big bang. Tesla understood this. This is why he said 369 is the key to the universe. And I put it together in a model called a 600-cell tetrahedron. Thank you, Rebecca.
It's absolutely fascinating, in the fact that Tesla and all of his work, all of his research, all of his discoveries were suppressed, not only for obviously for free energy, but for so much of this. Again, I think this all ties into the agenda to kill God and to kill the truth.
It is. It's all suppression of the truth. And this is why, you know, Einstein is vaunted, and you don't see on TV a show about Tesla, because Tesla really understood free energy, the ether, which is the plasma of the universe, and tapping into that as unlimited supply or source of energy, of all energy. It goes all the way down to the DNA. Tesla understood the structure of our DNA. Our DNA at the quantum scale, the geometric arrangement of quantum particles, is all about the tetrahedron.
Right. And I got to ask about the elite. I mean, how? Mm-hmm. Obviously, we have all this great technology, and I'm not technologically phobic. I like this stuff. I like to use it to spread the truth, to spread the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, to try to help people overcome many of the obstacles that we are faced with in this life. Obviously, we're living in the adversary's world. We're living in his realm. But how much of our technology to the elites is actually ancient? I mean, how far ahead are they?
Yeah, virtually all of this is derived from Egypt. That's the short answer. Tesla understood what the Egyptians had discovered, and it goes deeper than that. But what we're talking about today is technology that has been building all through the human race, let's call it, the human record. So what we are seeing is technology primarily for the control of the serf class, the masses. And very little of it will go to the elite, because all the elite are concerned with, all they really want is to achieve immortality. The rest of technology, be it Wi-Fi and our iPhones and all this other stuff, is meant to control us, if not to outright, like through vaccines, kill us or dumb us down. So the elite, really, all they want is to achieve or ascend to this next level, into this fifth age, into this age of Aquarius. They want to upload themselves into these new bodies and this new artificial intelligence. The rest of all this really cool whiz-bang virtual reality, which is part of the sentient world simulation, all of this other stuff is meant for the serf class. Very little of it will the elite even involve themselves in, it because they are not part of the serf class.
Yeah, I find it interesting that at the CDC and some of the other major health organizations, that they do not serve genetically modified foods in their cafeterias.
Bingo. There you go.
Big red flag, people.
They're not participating in what we are. All of this stuff is sold to us as being great advances, and isn't it wonderful to be in VR, and isn't it wonderful to have Pokemon, and all of this, you know, artificial revised reality presented to us. But, you know, I need to stop here for a moment, because it's really important, and I know you're right on step with me here. This is not fear-mongering. This is not to scare people. Quite the opposite. I do a 180 with this. My big thing is take the negative and spin it around 180 degrees and make it a positive. 180 what you see, and see it as not a warning sign, but that our redemption draws nigh, that Jesus Christ is coming back, that God is ultimately in control of this. And what we see playing out through the evil agenda is being allowed by God, being allowed because there has to be a decision, free will, choice made. You either go with the light or you go with the dark. I choose to go with the light. I choose to go with Jesus Christ. And this is why I present this evidence in technology, evidence of evil, to show that we are in the end times and that we need to make this decision today to accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior and accept the Holy Spirit, which then provides us the full armor of God to be able to conduct what really is spiritual warfare. This is not fighting against flesh and blood. This is fighting against evil, evil spirits. So I'll leave it there.
Absolutely. I'm unequivocally convinced, as I have grown older, and I'll be 49 in August, that that's what we are engaged in. The plight of humanity is based on this supernatural warfare going on between the fallen angels, the descendants of fallen angels, and obviously the good angels, and obviously God. And we have this, we have a choice to make, whether it be the dark side or the good side, whether it be light or dark. But I find it very interesting what you say about, number one, I look at this as like, hey, this is great. This, if I see this in my lifetime and I get to ascend to heaven, I'm not looking at this as fear either. But I find it very interesting that the New Agers obviously are talking about the light, but they are talking about Lucifer's light and not the truth and the light of God himself.
That is correct. It's a false light. It is a false set of promises and deception. And in fact, God allows for a great deception to befall those that turn away from him and go and worship Lucifer. So it really is a time of encouragement. We are to look up, for our redemption draweth nigh. So when we talk about the eclipse on the 21st of August, and I call it a harbinger, well, for those that are worshiping Lucifer, it's a harbinger of judgment coming. For those of us that worship Jesus Christ, it is a sign that we are in the end times and the age is coming to a close, and that they worship the notion of the golden age of Kronos, which is Saturn worshiping Satan. Their golden age, which you see all through popular culture and advertisements now, gold is everywhere. And this whole advancement of the owl, the image of the owls, Moloch, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, all of that is advancing.
And I mentioned this in the last show we did too, because as I read about the golden age of Kronos, I kept thinking about the song Purple Haze by Jimi Hendrix, because they believed that the world was actually at one time had a purple sky, purple light, purple haze all in my brain. Can I kiss the sky? I mean, that it's just like, wow, was he involved in this whole thing? It just blows me away. But folks, this what we're talking about here isn't conspiracy theory, and I just want to quickly go through some technology headlines that we have seen just in the last 10 years. World's first genetically modified human embryo raises ethical concerns. Horrifying human-animal DNA experiment shows transhumanism in hybrids. Folks, they are doing this. The technology is there. Scientists create animals that are part human. Stem cell experiments leading to genetic mixing of species. Brain-computer interface, artificial brain interfacing, microelectronics, and the human visual system. Genome surgery, precise and easy ways to rewrite human genes. The new frontier of genome engineering with CRISPR-Cas9, which we spoke about. Elites are pouring billions into gene therapy research, but who will actually benefit from the advances in anti-aging treatment? I can guarantee you it's not going to be us, the plebs. Scientists take a step closer to eternal life as they preserve and revive the brain. This is not conspiracy theory, is it?
It is not conspiracy theory. And in fact, if you look at the venture capital and where it's all going in Silicon Valley, is all towards the goal of defeating death. That's the bottom line for them. All their money is going towards immortality.
Well, I can defeat death, but it's going to be through Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen. You know, this is a time for us. We're privileged to be living in these times, as you just cited. This is a very exciting time because we are not going to face death. We who have the Holy Spirit, we who have been given that gift, because we don't deserve it.
No.
You know, we're sinners. And I'm no better than anybody else. I'm no better than the researchers at CERN. I pray for everyone that's involved in this dark agenda because their souls are in jeopardy.
Yeah, as are all of ours. And that's why I opened the show with what I was talking about, because I struggle with that. You know, it's like, I do not deserve, I humbly admit to God that I do not deserve the reward he has in store for me through my faith and my belief in Jesus Christ. But at the same time, my love of Yahweh and my fellow man, which is what many Christians say, that's all the rules there are. Actually, that's what compels me not to sin, to stay as close to God as I can. But, you know, I'm like you. It's like, good grief. Some days it's a struggle and a half.
It really is. And, you know, you mentioned the alphabet agencies earlier in NSA. It's amazing we got through this 2 hours without being interfered with. And it's interesting. The last several shows I've done, both with Kev Baker on TFR and my own, you know, by myself, so to speak, but Kev is always there to help me. We have seen a drop off in this interference, and it kind of makes me wonder, okay, guys, you've been really, you know, hitting me hard here on the technology interference. What's going on? But I give credit to the Holy Spirit and the full armor of God. He just keeps polishing that armor and he keeps making it tougher and thicker and stronger, because I have no fear. This is an already defeated foe. Already defeated foe. Satan's already been defeated through the blood of Jesus Christ. So this is a time to be cheerful and joyful and look up, because our redemption draws near.
Amen. Amen. And obviously, if you're experiencing problems, like I said at the top of the show, just mention Kim Kardashian's backside. It throws the NSA off. Anthony, I want to thank you for joining me again today. It's always an honor to have you on the program. Folks, tune in tomorrow. Truth Train Radio's Joseph Sikora will be here. We'll be talking a lot about vaccines, as tomorrow is the last day of the age of Autism Awareness Month. And we're going to be talking more about the dangers of vaccines and what it is that they're trying to do. Much love to everybody. God bless you, Tony, and God bless everybody on TFR.
God bless.